प्रदीप आवाज कम कर दें, यहाँ पे ज्यादा लाउड लग रही है आवाज। ग्रोवर साहब, वी आर एक्सपेरिमेंटिंग दिस थिंग फर्स्ट टाइम इन आर लैब। हमारे इंस्टीट्यूट में हमने काफी सारे लेक्चर करवाए हैं वीडियो कॉन्फ्रेंस के जरिए, लेकिन ये कम्युनिकेशन स्किल लैब में हमने पहली बार करवा रहे हैं अभी। हालांकि आईसीटी प्रोग्राम भी नहीं कर रहे हैं यहाँ पर, लेकिन वो आईसीटी के प्रोग्राम डिफरेंट रहते हैं। यहाँ पे हमारे पास 11 पार्टिसिपेंट हैं।
ओके,
11 में से 10 पार्टिसिपेंट यूपी से हैं, एक हरियाणा से हैं।
ओके,
एंड दे आर ऑल टीचर्स ऑफ पॉलिटेक्निक्स।
अच्छा, ऑल फ्रॉम पॉलिटेक्निक। ओके,
हाँ जी। तो हमने आपका जो आउटकम बेस्ड एजुकेशन सिस्टम जो है, उसमें आपका इंट्रोडक्शन, विजन, मिशन, प्रोग्राम, एजुकेशनल ऑब्जेक्टिव्स, फिर पीईओस एंड पीओस, सीओस एंड उनकी मैपिंग के बारे में आप इनको थोड़ा सा ब्रीफ करिएगा। एंड देन मे बी इफ देयर इज एनी क्वेश्चन, दे कैन कम ओवर हियर एंड देन दे कैन इंटरेक्ट विद यू आल्सो। तो आपकी मैंने थोड़ी सी ब्रीफ इंट्रोडक्शन इनको दी थी कि आप YMCA में प्रोफेसर हैं एंड ही हैज ए फर्स्ट हैंड एक्सपीरियंस ऑफ अप्रूविंग NBA एक्रेडिटेशन सिस्टम इन टीम, एंड ही इज अ रेगुलर, हम इनके काफी सारा इसी इंस्टीट्यूट में हम लोग इनको काफी बार बुलाते हैं अपने यहाँ पर टू शेयर हिज एक्सपीरियंसिस इन द एरिया ऑफ आउटकम बेस्ड एजुकेशन एंड ऑल्सो इन चॉइस बेस्ड क्रेडिट सिस्टम ऑल्सो। सर, इनको थोड़ा सा जो आपका एक्सपीरियंस है YMCA का चॉइस बेस्ड क्रेडिट सिस्टम के बारे में, जो भी YMCA में जो एक्सपीरियंस आपका, वो भी थोड़ा सा इनको ब्रीफ कर देना, बीच में ही टाइम लगेगा।
ठीक।
नाउ सर, वी विल कंटिन्यू टिल 1 o'clock, 1 बजे लंच ब्रेक कर लेंगे, फिर 2 बजे से लेकर 1 घंटा, 3 बजे, 3:30 बजे तक, जब तक आपके पास टाइम अवेलेबल रहेगा तो हम लोग आपके साथ जुड़े रहेंगे सर।
ठीक है।
सो वेल फ्रेंड्स, आपको आवाज आ रही है सबको ठीक ठाक? हम दोनों की आवाज नहीं दे रही है आपको, तो इसी तरह से ये आपके पीपीटी भी सर वहां से अपडेट करेंगे। जब इनको पीपीटी पे जाना होगा, जब इनको आपसे वैसे आपसे बात करनी होगी, तो ये अपने जैसे अब आप सर को देख रहे हैं वीडियो के ऊपर, सर आपकी पिक्चर यहाँ पे हमारे पास स्क्रीन के ऊपर आ रही है, तो ही विल कंट्रोल दैट सिस्टम देयर।
अब आपको मेरी पिक्चर आ रही है या पीपीटी आ रही है?
अब मेरे को आपकी पिक्चर आ रही है सर।
ओके।
अब आप पीपीटी करके देखिए, तो एक बार पीपीटी करके देखिए सर।
अब पीपीटी नहीं आ रही? अभी
नहीं, अभी नहीं आ रही
सर। आप स्क्रीन शेयर कर दीजिए।
स्क्रीन शेयर करेंगे तब आएगी सर।
सर नाउ ओपन योर प्रेजेंटेशन।
हाँ जी, अब आपकी पीपीटी आ रही है सर।
ओके,
हाइट सर, हाइट पे क्लिक कर दीजिए। यस सर, आप फुल स्क्रीन कर दीजिए।
तो सर, आपके ये सारा कंट्रोल आपके पास दे दिया मोनिका। मोनिका इज अवर टेक्निकल स्टाफ फ्रॉम एजुकेशनल टेलीविजन सेंटर, ईटीवी सेंटर से। तो यहाँ बहुत एफर्ट करके सर से कल भी एक प्रैक्टिस करी थी हमने, और आप ठीक से काम कर रहे हैं, आई एम हैप्पी फॉर दैट सर। विदाउट नाउ यू नो हैविंग फर्दर एनी काइंड ऑफ डिस्कशंस ऑन दिस, आई विल रिक्वेस्ट यू टू काइंडली एंगेज द सेशन ऑन educational objectives and learning outcomes. Thank you so much.
Okay. Thank you. Hello. Yeah. Good morning, everyone.
Yes, sir.
One of you can come here and interact with me. जब लोग good morning के बजाय सिर्फ बात कर रहे हैं
तो। Yes, sir. You can continue with your lecture.
Yeah. Should we start?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so good morning, all the participants. I am Sandeep Grover, as I have been introduced. Now, today we will talk about educational objectives and learning outcomes. But before that, since the course is on choice-based credit system, you know, very briefly, I will, very shortly, I will give you an introduction about the choice-based credit system. Now see, in our academic curriculum, one of the very important components is academic flexibility. Academic flexibility is of various types. Now, since you people are in a polytechnic institutions, academic flexibility is a concept where we say that we are giving a choice to the students. Number one, in terms of the entry. Number two, in terms of the exit. And number three, in terms of during the process. So when I say a student after passing out, say for example, class 12th, he enters an engineering degree course, but there is an option that after doing diploma, he can directly enter in the second year. So that is academic flexibility. Similarly, there are certain exit options in various institutions where a student can exit the course by taking a diploma or by taking a degree. So that is at the entry and at the exit. But when I talk about during the process, it says that during the process, he must be given a choice of what he should study and what he can leave so that he is able to get the degree. Now, choice-based credit system is a holistic document which primarily says that, number one, the degree is to be linked to the number of credits. So if you want to do an engineering degree, then you must pass, say, for example, 160 credits. So that is only possible if we give a certain amount of flexibility to the students in CBCA system. That means I must float my course more than 160 credits. So that, say, for example, if the course is of 175 credits, then he is given a choice that if he secures or if he clears the papers of 160 credits, he is given a degree. Second important part in the choice-based credit system is that all your courses must have course outcomes, or we also call them as the learning outcomes. So when we are doing a part of education objectives and learning outcomes, it is also mandatory as per, say, for example, accreditation purpose of MBA, and also as per the requirements of the choice-based credit system. So with this as base, I move on to my presentation. So this would be, you know, in general, I will talk about the basic introduction to the choice-based credit system, outcome-based education system. From where all this concept has come is the Bloom's taxonomy. And what is the importance of Bloom's taxonomy vis-a-vis our regulatory bodies? Similarly, how do we decide about starting from the hierarchical structure, right from the vision and mission to the course outcomes? And how do we write down the course objectives and the outcomes? And finally, relation between them, the mapping. And I got some case studies to show you that how course outcomes are written, how they are measured, and how the attainment is calculated. So with this, basic introduction, see, every program of any level, whether it is a UG course, whether it is a PG course, when I say program, I mean, I am talking about a course which you normally call as, say, for example, BTEC in electrical engineering is a program, diploma in mechanical engineering is a program. So when I say courses, then I'm talking about the right. So objectives are primarily the statements which describe what learner is expected to achieve as a result of instruction. That means instruction means during that period of 3 years or during a period of one semester, that is the course particular, which tend to describe the specific discrete unit of knowledge and the skill. So objective is telling beforehand what I want to achieve. Similarly, the outcomes, they describe the broad aspects which incorporate a wide range of knowledge and skill. That is demonstration of knowledge based on the subjects and the skill that he or she has acquired through the course, what is expected at the end of the course. Now, our education system is drifting towards the outcome-based education system. Now, outcome can be in terms of knowledge, in terms of skills, in terms of values, in terms of attitudes. Similarly, when we talk about outcome-based education system, focus is on the evolution of outcome of the program, that is a particular diploma course or a degree course, though input and output parameters are also important. Now let me give you an overall idea that what is difference between output based education system and the outcome based education system. So when I say output based education system, I am talking about the marks that are scored by the students and the grades scored by the students, and maybe a part of the some placement also. But when I say outcome based education system, I am concerned about what knowledge he has gained and how he or she is able to use that knowledge or skill in the future in industry or in the professional career. For example, if I make a statement that 80% of my students have secured marks more than 75%, then that is an output based statement. Similarly, if I say that 70% of my students are now able to apply the knowledge and the skill gained in the professional career, then that is an outcome based education system. Similarly, the objectives that we define beforehand, they should be specific, they should be measurable, they should be achievable, they should be realistic and time bound. That means, just like that, you cannot write objectives of any course or any program. They have to be very particular, and you must ensure that you are able to achieve them and measure them during a period of the time. That period of time can be 3 years also, that can be 4 years also. Whereas when you talk about outcomes, they are primarily written always in the future tense. So my student to do with the knowledge that he or she has gained during a period of 3 years or 4 years. So beginning with the end in mind, that is something like that. These are the objectives with end keeping in my mind that these will be the outcomes that I will be able to achieve. So for any program, you know, engineering program, science program, maybe BSc program or BCom program, even medical program, it is always desirable to have objectives and the outcomes at the department level, at the program level, and for each course in the curriculum. So this we will go in detail also, this hierarchy, in the later slides. So let us now conceptualize what is difference between a goal, objective, and an outcome. So when I say goal, you know, it is something like which is point oriented. Goal is always a point oriented thing, whereas objective is particularly a direction. So say for example, play a game of hockey or a football, we say goal only when the ball passes through the two poles. So that is a goal that has been achieved. Objective can be various actions. So to achieve a goal, you can have multi objective. That means many objective can take you to a goal. Similarly, goal is the ultimate end result, whereas objective is a statement describing what the project is tending to achieve. So there can be multiple objective, multiple statements, but the goal is only one, that is a single goal or a single statement. So education, when we say outcome based, as I told you, these are the statements of what a student will know or be able to do if he or she has learned everything in the course or the session, or the result of the program operations or activities or the effects produced by the program. Similarly, as in the case of objectives, this also can be mapped to a specific objective or maybe a cumulative result of the objectives in the education system also. Okay, so this is just an example that I have, you know, earlier also I told in the terms of students. So output is students' grades or the students' graduation rates or the employment status. So if I say 70% is output based statement. Now what the students actually learn, say for example PhD. So when you do a M.Tech or PhD, one thing is you are getting a degree, or say for example you have published say 40 papers. Now number of publications is the output data. But what I am able to do with that publication, its application in the industry or the society, so those things talk about the outcome-based education system. So when we talk about outcome-based education system, it does not mean that output is not important. Output is also important, but then we must be careful that the desired outcome has been achieved. Okay, so this is a background to the our whole concept of, you know, education technology in terms of the outcome-based education system. From where this the concept of learning outcomes or the course outcomes has come. So before we start this, are there any questions on the previous slide? On the basic introduction part?
No, sir.
No questions? Okay. So now let us talk about the Bloom's taxonomy. See, in our education scenario, in our education system, we are primarily talking or we are primarily working in three different domains. One is called affective domain, one is called psychomotor domain, and one is called cognitive domain. So when I say affective domain, it is the development in the areas dealing with the emotions and the attitudes. Similarly, psychomotor domain is learning physical or manual skills or the performance of the action. And cognitive domain, it is a gaining knowledge or thinking skills. Now, in each three of them, there are different institutions, types of learning going on in the different types of, say, colleges or the institutions. Say, for example, when I say affective domain, now that school, that college, that institution, where we are dealing with the development in the areas dealing with emotions and the attitude. So what type of, you know, schools or colleges you expect them where you change emotions and attitudes? Say, for example, your hospital is an institution where the emotions and attitudes are changed. Say, for example, National School of Drama, where you are being taught how to look happy even if you are not happy. Or say Film Institute Pune, where we are dealing with the only with the emotions, behavioral aspect. So that type of teaching is affective domain. Similarly, what is psychomotor? The meaning of the word psychomotor is coordination of eye hand movement is called psychomotor. So when I am learning how to run a lathe machine, so that means I require coordination between my eyes, between my hands, no, between the various body parts. Or those schools or colleges where it is being taught, those academies where it is being taught how to play cricket, how to play hockey, or say, for example, how to run a guitar, how to play harmonium, how to play tabla. So you understand, this is psychomotor, coordination of eye hand movement. So those type of institutions where we are teaching the concept of those academies where we are teaching these concepts. Say, for example, National Institute of Sports, Patiala, where you are being taught, where you are being trained how to play hockey. So psychomotor domain, those types of school colleges come. Similarly, third is the main cognitive domain where we all are working, where it is the intellectual or the thinking skills or gaining knowledge. We are teaching, we are giving knowledge. So all schools, sorry, all polytechnics, all engineering colleges, they come under the third domain. So when I say cognitive domain or psychomotor domain or affective domain are independent of each other, no, they are not independent. There is always an overlapping. Even in polytechnics, even in engineering colleges, not only knowledge I am giving, I am also giving some input about the psychomotor domain. That is, I am teaching them how to run a machine. I am also teaching them how to have a better behavioral aspects. So that means in a polytechnic, domain is main, but there is also some part of psychomotor domain and also some part of the affective domain. Similarly, when I talk about psychomotor domain, there is a more part of psychomotor domain than less part of cognitive domain and less part of the affective domain. So all these things are interlinked, but wherever we are talking, the base will be of that particular domain only. So now each of these different domains, there are levels of learning, lower level to higher level. So we will talk only about the concrete domain where we all are working. So in that case, the levels of learning from the basic level of learning of knowledge to the highest level of learning, that is evaluation. Say this one. So you will be surprised to know that the lowest level of learning is knowledge in Bloom's taxonomy for the cognitive domain. Next higher level is comprehension, then application, then analysis, then synthesis, and then finally the evaluation at the highest level of learning. Now, why these levels of learning are important? Because when I am teaching, I must understand that what type of inputs I have to give in this particular course. And similarly, at the time of assessment, I must know what type of questions I am asking to test the knowledge. Now, what is knowledge? Knowledge is nothing but it is just remembering of previously learned material or the facts. Recall data is knowledge. If I know what is capital of Germany, it is knowledge. So knowledge is just, if I know what are the various parts of a drilling machine, it's knowledge. So knowledge is just remembering the fact and recall of the data. But next, first is I must remember that yes, this is a drilling machine. Yes, this is a milling machine. Yes, this is an oscilloscope. So that is knowledge. Next comes comprehension, the ability to grasp the meaning of knowledge being learned. That means if this is a, say, lathe machine or if this is an oscilloscope, then what are the various parts of this? The meaning. And finally, I move on to slowly and slowly teach in class also. First we tell, see, this is this machine, these are the parts, and then this is interrelationship between the parts, and then that these are the functions of various parts. So similarly, this type of level they go on, and we go up to the analysis, synthesis, and the evaluation part. So evaluation is the highest level, ability to judge the value. Now the Bloom's taxonomy says that when I am setting a question paper or when I am writing a course outcomes, in that case also I must be able to correlate these various levels with the Bloom's taxonomy levels with the verbs. So for this it says that to identify that which level I am using, I must use different types of verbs. Say for example, if I'm talking about knowledge, then I am asking a question or I'm writing in course outcome, words like define is a basic word, distinguish, identify the parts of this machine, label the diagram, or say match. So these are the lowest levels of learning. So if I want to display them in my course outcomes or in my question papers, then these words will correlate that yes, this is a knowledge or this is the lowest level. Similarly, comprehend, the ability to grasp the meaning of knowledge being learned, associate, describe, differentiate, discuss, and so on. So you will find that there is some overlapping also, but more or less these are the verbs that are being used. Application part, illustrate, apply, so analyze, synthesis, and finally is the evaluation. Now you will see that there is a word called validate. Now where do we word this use validate? Validate is actually checking our own work in market. It can be in terms of experimental basis, it can be on the basis of market research or whatever it is. That evaluation is the highest level, and validation is whatever you have discovered that you are going to validate in the. So what I mean to say is that the different verbs that I have shown you here are being mapped with the different types of the levels of the learning. Okay, now these are the different levels, lowest to highest in the various other domains. This earlier what I have shown you, this one, this we were talking about the third domain, that is a cognitive domain, concerned with the domain only. So that's why I have shown you details about the cognitive domain, but otherwise for your knowledge, these are the levels of lowest to highest for the affected domain, receiving, responding, valuing, organizing, characterizing when we talk about the behavior. Similarly, these are the levels of the psychomotor domain, action-based. Perception is the lowest level. Now, what is perception? Say, for example, in psychomotor domain, we teach or we, you know, train how to play cricket. Now, in cricket, when you catch a ball at the boundary, a bowler is basically doing a perception that where actually ball is going to land so that he can take his hands towards that side. That is actually called perception. So there are different levels of learning in you know, all three different domains. And this is, you know, Bloom's taxonomy that we have just seen, and the revised version of this Bloom's taxonomy that was the original one. Here also the stages are more or less same. Remember is referring to your, you know, knowledge. Remember, understand, apply, analyze, evaluate, and the create. These are again the, you know, same levels of learning. So something you can see, the similar things are written, like in the lowest one, define, duplicate, list. I mean, the same set of the verbs in the Bloom's taxonomy. So why Bloom's taxonomy? As I told you, there are different levels for different domain. So it is not that you are just directly jumping to a section, but it is a different types of the levels. Now let me give you a very basic example. Say when a child is there of 2, 2.5 years, 3 years, what is the first thing you tell to the child? Initially you tell something about the knowledge, that is, these are your eyes, you know, this is your nose, so that is giving the knowledge. Slowly and slowly, when they grow up, then they are learning different type of things in the school. So there is a different level of learning in the different domain. Similarly, to encourage higher order thought in students by building up from the lower level. So there are some students which you see are outstanding or brilliant. So accordingly, you can work upon them depending on what type of input you are giving. Say, for example, research paper, you can ask a student to study, who has studied your notes also and the books also. Why? Because he wants to study more. So a level higher than what is expected can also be given. Similarly, this can be used as a teaching tool to help balance assessment and evaluative questions. As I told you, in the questions also, when I put up a question, I use the words like describe, you know, describe the process, or analyze, or prove. So those verbs, those words will show that what type of question I'm asking in terms of the assessing the level at the different levels of the Bloom's taxonomy. And similarly, you ensure all orders of thinking are excited in students' learning. And finally, and very important, that these verbs of taxonomy, these levels are incorporated in the course outcomes. So each course outcome, you will find that there is one verb of this type. So that will come with the help of example later on. Okay. So this regulatory body, you know, examples I have already told you that in regulatory bodies, how the role of course outcomes is important. It is important in NBA accreditation also. In NBA accreditation, if some of you might be having some idea about the NBA accreditation, then there are specific sections which talk about the program education objectives, you know, program outcomes, course outcomes, their measurement, their attainment. Similarly, in NAAC accreditation also, there is a component in the new system of NAAC accreditation, the revised system, where we talk about the course outcomes and the program outcomes and their measurement and their attainment. And the choice-based credit system also ensures that each of the courses in the choice base, whether it is a core course or it is an elective, open elective, it's a discipline elective, or it's a, you know, audit course. So any type of course you are talking, each course must have course outcome. So what are course outcomes? That will come little later on. So this is the importance of you know, your outcome based education system in the NBA accreditation, NAAC accreditation, and the CBCS. So this is just an example showing you the table of in NBA accreditation, how this is important. There are various marks. Say, for example, you see course outcomes and program outcomes. Similarly, in NAAC, This is a document from the NAC. This page is from NAC. You find that students in 2.6, you find the student learning outcomes. This is also taken from the NAC document. Program outcome, program specific outcome, and course outcomes of all programs of the institution are stated and displayed on the website. So, upload. Just to show you how important or how the program outcomes are important in CBC system and the NBH system. Okay, now this is the hierarchical structure, a systematic, we talk about vision statement. Vision statement is at the institution or the departmental level. That means each institution, each college is having a vision statement. I think that you must be having in your institution also. Then department level also vision statement. And then next level of hierarchy is the mission statement. Each institution is in line with the vision statement, certain mission statements also at the institutional level and at the department level. Third is the objective and the outcomes, that is at program level. That means any program, diploma engineering, will have, which as per NBA system we call them as the program educational objectives or the PEOs. And similarly, the outcomes are named by the word program outcomes or the program specific outcomes. So each, whether it is a diploma program or a degree program, each program will have PEOs and the POs, that is a program education objectives and the program outcome. So for example, in one department, there can be more than two programs. So for example, mechanical department can have diploma in production also, diploma in mechanical also, diploma in automobile also. So each of these diplomas will then have program education objectives and the program outcomes. And next is the objectives at the course level or at the, or which we call also call them at the course outcomes or the learning outcomes. So that means in each diploma course, you will have for each course you will have outcomes. Say for example, in a 3-year diploma course, say for example, if you are teaching them 30 subjects or the 30 courses, so each course will have course outcomes. That is the meaning of the course outcome. Okay. So this is just a relationship when I talk about institution vision mission, department mission, PEOs and the POs, and finally the COs. So these are the levels, and horizontal linkage says that they are at the which level? They are at the institution level, at the internal quality assurance cell, or the department of vision and mission. Horizontal level is the department advisory board. That means when I make department vision and mission, then it must be the core purpose of the department advisory board. That means department advisory board has to oversee that vision and mission are okay. And finally, there is a program assessment committee. For each program, there can be assessment committee and a program coordinator, which have a horizontal linkage with the program education objectives and the program outcomes. And finally, CO is at the course level. So for each course, there is a coordinator. Sometimes there are more than one teachers which are teaching a course. Say for example, engineering drawing, can be a subject, or physics can be a subject which is being taught by say 2 or 3 or 4 teachers. There will be one course coordinator, and all of them will together sit and make the course outcomes. Now all these things, whenever you are formulating department vision mission or institution vision mission or PO, there is an interaction of the stakeholder. Stakeholders means the students, the faculty, the alumni, the industry, and the regulatory body. So these stakeholders have their input through survey, or maybe through meetings, or maybe through workshops. So that means the involvement of stakeholders is also important whenever we are making all these things. Similarly, there is an example. Say for example, vision, when I say vision is like a dream, you must have seen your institution vision. It's a dream, shared dream for the institution, where we want to and where we want to look like when we reach there. So it is not only a dream of a single person or four or five people together, it is a dream which is of the whole institution. Similarly, mission dictates the efforts and initiatives you undertake to achieve mission. So mission is a statement, whereas when I talk about, vision is a statement, whereas when I talk about mission, those are three, four, five, those bullet points, those numbered points, which help us to achieve the vision. And the vision and mission are correlated and co-created. That means it is not that vision I am making today and mission I will make after 3 years. No. They are correlated, interrelated to each other and co-created, created almost together through a collaborative process. That means a process in which I am involving lot many other experts also. So in vision and mission, I must ensure that all stakeholders are involved. So when I'm making vision mission statements, it is not only the faculty members, it is not only the management, but also you must have a representation from the industry, you must have a representation from your employers, and you must have representation from the alumni also, the students that have passed out from the institution. And then you must seek alignment, not agreement. Alignment is you are able to, you know, align your thoughts, align what you think, okay, this should be there, this should be not there. Agreement is, okay, if you say I agree, no, that is not agreement. Here we require alignment of the our thoughts and what we want to write down in the vision and mission statements. And it is but natural that vision and mission of the department to be derived from the vision and mission of the institution. So first is you will make vision and mission of the college or the vision and mission of the institution, and then from that vision and mission you will derive the vision and mission of the department, because your department cannot go beyond what your institution is thinking or what your institution want to achieve. And vision and mission of the department is to be focused on the area of the department. Your specialization can be in VLSA, your specialization in the physician. What is the area here you are specialized? So you have what you that vision mission should be followed by the SWOT analysis. That means SWOT is strength, weaknesses, opportunities and the threats, or now it is also called concerns. So department, what are the threats or the concerns? Then accordingly. A vision statement of an institution can be to produce highly skilled, trained, competent and confident engineers having passion for technology with a positive attitude, self-respect, discipline and an urge to become successful professionals and responsible citizens. So you see many words are included here. I am using word skill also, competent also, confidence also, attitude also, discipline also, and something about the citizenship also. So my vision is a dream that now to achieve this vision, what mission or what work has to be done by the institution. This is an example. Similarly, this can be a mission of an institution. So normally vision is a statement which we write in a running sentence, and mission are written in the bullet statements. So mission can be to provide quality education with the aim to produce engineers of high professional competence and integrity. Similarly, it will talk about research and development, you know, creative thinking of the students. And accordingly, there can be a vision statement of the department also. Say, for example, this is a vision statement of a computer engineering department. To be a center of excellence by producing high caliber computer engineers who possess scientific temperament and would engage in hardware, software and design activities with a flair for research with capability access. So this is vision statement of one of the departments, that is a computer engineering department. Okay, so likewise this can be a mission statement of a computer engineering department to provide C students a high quality engineering education and contribute new knowledge through research in computer engineering and allied disciplines. Fine. And the department seeks to maintain recognition through scholarly work and service to institution, university and the community. So that the department is talking about not only the teaching work, but also the other service to the institution, to the whole university as a whole, or to the community or for the social cause. Similarly, it talks about the sports activities, other extracurricular activities, skills, communication skills, team spirit. So you see that all the, you know, requirements to become a good citizen, you have to inculcate in the student. It is not only teaching, it is not only classroom, but outcome based education says that a holistic, you know, concept has to be there. So this is another example, you know, vision and mission statement of a college. Similarly, another example, you know, vision can be as short as to be center of excellence in technical education. And then accordingly, you can have certain mission statements. Now, this is how do we write objectives and outcomes. So I told you that when I talk about objectives and outcomes, okay, before this, is there any question on this? On the vision mission statements? Any question on vision mission?
Sir, no questions, they are saying.
Okay. So when I talk about writing objectives and outcomes, the word that is being used is the, in place of objectives is program educational objectives or the PEOs. Whereas when I talk about program outcomes, so program is my diploma in electrical engineering or BTEC in mechanical engineering. So I need to write down program education objectives for each program and program outcomes for each program. The whole thing has started from Abbott's Accreditation Board of Engineering and Technology, that is in US, United States. And our country, you know, our NBA system, you know, is a permanent signatory, which includes all these things. So we are following the outcome-based education system, that is the part. And POs, as I told you, they relate to the skill, knowledge, behavior that students acquire through a program. Now, POs are actually, you know, statements 3 to 5 in number, but whenever you write the statements, they must state who is involved, what are the desired outcome, that is at the end of the course, how the progress is to be measured, what is the target of identifying the success, and what is the time frame that after the at the end of the course, that is at the end of the 3 years or 4 years. So say for example, if I talk about program education objectives in an electric engineering program, now these are actually not POs, these are actually breakup of POs. So it is expected that a person who is doing a diploma or a degree in electric engineering program, he will have number one objective is technical knowledge, right? Similarly, he will have objectives will be he must have some technical skills also, and then computer skills are also important these days. So one of the objectives will be to incorporate the computer skills. Similarly, communication skills are communicate through a language, competence may not be demonstrated. Similarly, one of the objectives can be a professional skill or social awareness and lifelong learning. So this is a breakup basically. How we write PEO, that I will show you. So you must ensure, you must find out that what is the objective of doing a diploma program. And then you will be able to find out the, write down the PEOs. So this block diagram just shows that how PEOs are made. So PEOs are primarily starting from the department vision mission, and department vision mission starting from the vision mission of the institution. So you have, as I told you, you have a department advisory committee. So they will take input from the stakeholders, is the employer, faculty, staff, alumni, parents, and the students. And accordingly, they will draft a rough of a PEO program. Then it goes to the program assessment committee. If it is okay, if it requires revision, if it is yes, then you go back to the loop, or otherwise you finalize your PEOs and get approval from a competitor. Now, why I have shown you this block diagram is that writing down vision, mission statements and PEOs is not that simple that you just sit down and write down something. No, it has to be through a collaborative process by involvement of various people, various stakeholders. Then you must check them once, twice, and then only you will be able to finalize the what are the POs. Because once you finalize POs, you should not think of changing them before 3 to 5 years. So that's why it is very important how do you write them. So this is similar thing that I have shown you in the previous slide, that PEO starting from the stakeholders input, which can be industry, LI, and so on. Then you have a department advisory board where head of department is also a part. Then these POs assessment evaluation is to be done with inputs from the vision and mission and the graduate attributes. Okay, now this is an actual PEO. This is the program educational objectives for a BTech program in mechanical engineering. So these are the 5 points. So you remember that as per NBA guidelines, the number of points should be between 3 to 5, either 3 points or 4 or 5. So you cannot write a PEO with say 10 points, no, or only with 1 point or with 2 point, no. Preferably it should be 3 to 5 in number. So for BTech program mechanical engineering, one of the objectives is to prepare students for successful careers in industry that meet the needs of industrial and the Indian and the multinational companies. Similarly, to develop the ability among students to synthesize data and technical concepts for application to product design. So you see, it incorporates everything. Multidisciplinary projects also, it talks about the sound foundation of mathematical sciences also, lifelong learning also, professional ethics also. So, you know, whatever activity you are doing during this period of a course of say 3 years, everything has to be reflected through a project, through a PEO. Say for example, the PO number 4, it says that to provide students with a sound foundation in mathematical, scientific and engineering fundamentals. So somebody can ask you that why teach a physics to students in first year? So why? Why? Because yes, it's a part of our objective. It says that sound fundamental in mathematical, scientific and engineering fundamentals. So that is why whatever activity you are doing, it can be a sports activity, it can be a culture program, it can be a seminar, it can be a project work, it can be industrial visit. So whatever activity you are doing in that during this period of 3 years, everything should be connected to your program educational objectives. Fine. So this is another example, vision, mission and PEOs of computer science and engineering. Okay, so learning outcomes or the course outcomes, they are always written in future tense. What at the end, you know, and they should clearly indicate the nature and level required to achieve them successfully. Now, when I this is just a way of writing, I think let us leave this. I will make you clear with the help of an example. So when you write on program outcomes, you must be able to answer these questions. What do you want your students to know by the time they finish your program? So that must be reflected in the program outcome. What do you want your students to be able to do with what they know? That means, and what do you want your students to care about? That is the, you're talking about the social, you know, concept also, community thing also, and also the lifelong learning. But primarily any program, any diploma program, any degree program, these will be the 4 components of the outcomes. Yeah. Knowledge outcomes, skill outcomes, attitude and value outcome, and finally the behavioral outcomes. Now, how you incorporate, what level, what subjects, that is a, you know, different aspect. But more or less, these are the four dimensions of the program outcomes. Okay, these are the graduate attributes. I think this you can find in NBA document also. They are related to program outcomes only. This is for a degree program. Actually, I have one example. This is the program outcome. These have been given by the NBA for degree and diploma both. So in NBA document, at the end in lecture, you will find in SAR, in diploma SAR also, that NBA has already given that what should be the program outcome. So if you want to add certain specific outcomes which are known by the name of program specific outcomes or the PSOs. So any graduate must have this engineering knowledge, problem analysis, design development solutions, modern tool usage and so on. So I think you can find out of SAR that these program outcomes are already given. So what you would write for your department, for your program, is the program specific outcomes. And program specific outcomes, when we say, they are the beyond program outcomes. They are specific to particular program. Beyond PS, you should not repeat whatever has been written in these POs. Beyond that, you must write on the program specific. As I told you, say, if you are running a diploma program in mechanical engineering, then the diploma program in mechanical engineering and any other polytechnic would also be similar. But then your strength can be, say, for example, some specialization in automobile. Then you can write down your, you know, PSOs where at least one of the PSOs will be related to automobile. Or you are running a course in diploma in electronics engineering, but then you have got some specialization that beyond whatever is covered in the you know, curriculum, you're also giving them on-hand experience for certain softwares that are being used in industry. So your PSO can include that particular software also. So your PSOs are beyond POs and specific or specialization of a particular program only. And they are also 2 to 4 in number, not more than that. 2 to 3 or 2 to 4. And they must be realistic and achievable with program curriculum. You should not give, you know, anything which they are not achievable. Realistic, they must be achievable with the program curriculum and or activities with the program. Activities means any short-term course, any specialized, you know, training to the students, maybe through industry. So you are trying to incorporate something beyond what normal other people are. So that you can include in the program specific outcomes. So these can be a PSOs for a BTEC program in ECE, or maybe similar to diploma also. Specify design, prototype and test modern electronic systems that perform analog and digital signal processing functions, and similarly the second one. So they are only specific to the particular program and beyond the POs. Okay, so this is something where, you know, in outcome-based education system, or even in the you know, the concept of NBA, we talk about mapping of faculty expertise. Now, all these names are fictitious, all these qualifications, everything is fictitious. It's just a table to show you that how mapping is being done. So, mapping means you are trying to correlate the subjects with the faculty. That is what is the meaning of the mapping relationship, you know, matching. So when you are mapping these faculty expertise, it is mapped basically on 3 counts. Number 1, on the basis of qualification. Number 3, on the basis of experience. Number 2, on the basis of experience. And number 3, on the basis of the some specialized training, some specialized course. Say somebody is from industry. He or she has worked in industry for, say, for example, 30 years. So that industry personnel will become expertise to some subjects which you can give him. So this is the mapping shows that all your subjects are primarily, you have got faculty expertise, you got experts who can take upon that subject. So this is just a, you know, a way of demonstrating that yes, you have got some expert faculty relating to your courses and your program. So similarly, this is contribution to outcomes. So outcome is, you know, when I say objective and outcome, I normally say that objective and outcome are like banks of a river. You know, a river has got two banks. So you have to transfer from one bank to another bank. So objective is something which you decide beforehand, and outcome is which you expect. So during this 3-year course, you are doing so many things. So those so many things are contribution to the outcomes. They can be through classroom lectures, they can be through lab work, through some suggested readings, or maybe some home assignments that you are giving, some books you are providing for reading, some presentations, video lectures, some team exercise, some industrial visit. So this is the outcome in relation to the curriculum for any program. Now, when we talk about assessment, you know, assessment is you assess a student. Similarly, you need assessment whether the outcomes that we decided, whether they have been achieved or not. So that assessment of outcomes is done in two ways. One is called the direct assessment and another is called the indirect assessment. Direct assessment is primarily where directly you are assessing first-hand experience. So for example, students are securing, you say that, okay, 60%, 40% marks, so this is a direct assessment. Similarly, other forms of assessment like term and exams, lab evaluation, or other forms of direct assessment. Indirect assessment is you do not assess them directly. It is through somebody, through a survey. Say, for example, a course and survey. We do a survey at the end of the course, at the end of the semester. There can be student exit survey that at the end of 3 years of diploma, a student is doing something. And then doing it with the help of the survey. There can be employer survey. Employer can tell you that, yes, this student, he passed from your college, and this is my experience with him. So whether those outcomes have been achieved or not, these are the indirect ways to assess them. Really, co-curricular extra activities where the teamwork you are able to assess, you know, through some communication skills you are able to assess through some means. So these are the methods of the direct and the indirect outcomes. Of the previous slide, the only thing is that I have done the bifurcation as internal assessment and the external assessment. Okay. Now this is where you talk about the mapping of the structure. So when I say mapping of the structure, you know, I have been talking about, you know, vision, mission, PEOs, PO, course outcome. So this is mapping. Vision and mission of an institution are to be mapped with each other. There has to be a relationship between them so that you can prove that a mission has been derived from the vision statement. Similarly, in a vision has to be. Now this one, the education objectives and outcomes, you may or may not map, but yes, of course, the mapping is always there. Then course objectives, and very important is the COPO mapping. COPO is outcome and program outcome. Program outcomes are, say, for example, 12 in number. And course outcomes are, say, for example, 4 to 6 in number. So there is a mapping, there is a table, there is a matrix that we'll see later on, at how the course outcomes are leading to the program outcomes. And very important is a question paper CO mapping. So in each question paper, in front of each question, you must write down that this question is mapping with course, which course outcome in the syllabus. So maybe the whole course outcome, the whole question, or maybe a part, say, for example, 2A, 2B. So 2A can map with CO2 and 2B can map with CO3. So one side you got the questions and one side you got course outcome. So it ensures that the whole question paper is from the number one, from the whole syllabus, no outcomes. And secondly, it helps us to assess that what level of questions we are asking primarily in the question paper. Okay. So this is an example of when program education of text when PEOs are, you know, mapping. So here you see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 are the PEOs. 1 to 12 are the program outcomes. The star shows that just this PO is mapping with this outcome. So that means there should be no row or no column which is left blank. So this typically says that there is a relationship. Some of the PEOs are leading you to the program outcomes, maybe vice versa, or two program outcomes are coming from one PEO, or two PEOs are leading to the one program outcome. Okay, so next we come to the course outcomes. Now course outcomes are very important, because for each course, for each subject, you will have to write down the course outcomes. Now outcomes, as I told you, there are PEOs also, POs also, and course outcomes also. So you must first understand the hierarchy, because otherwise you will not be able to write down the course outcomes. You must understand the hierarchy, right from the vision mission to the PEOs, objectives of the department, and then to the program outcomes. You have to write course outcome for the each subject. So course outcomes are narrower statements that describe what students are expected to know or be able to do at the end of each course. So at the end of each course, what do you expect? That when I have taught this course for one semester, these will be the knowledge that the student might have gained, these will be the skills, or these are the behavior that student might have acquired during this course of 6 months. That is one semester. So now course means we are only talking about the subjects only. Okay. So I have a case study with me, which will thoroughly take you through that. Start the the concept of the syllabus in our typical colleges, in the diploma institutions or the degree institutions, and then how do we write down the course outcome, and how do we map these course outcomes with the program outcome. So I think if there are any questions before that, because then this is a specific total case study, so I want that the concepts before that is clear to you, and I would like you to interact on some questions or some queries in your mind.
Sir, PEOs define kar dijiye.
PEOs?
Yes, sir.
PEOs are the objectives that we set before starting a course, that what are the objectives of doing this program. Program means a diploma program or a degree program. So for this program, what are the objectives, why I am going for that particular course. Say for example, this is the PEO of a B.Tech program in mechanical engineering. PEOs are always 3 to 5 in numbers. Like these are 5 PEOs, so they are preferably 3 to 5 in numbers. And I must ensure that whatever I am doing in this course of 3 years or 4 years, everything is included in this. So for each program, there is a mandatory requirement of NB also, that you will have to write on the PEOs.
Okay. Sir, no more questions.
So I think now the case study I will take up, it's almost going. So I think that I can take after that, because the whole case study will go in the one go only.
Yeah, sir. Right now we can have a lunch break, and we can start at 2 o'clock.
Okay,
sir. Then we'll have a lunch break. So we'll have a lunch break, and we'll reassemble again at 2. Right. सर आप कनेक्ट ही रखिए, आप बस अपना माइक ऑफ मैं कर देती हूँ आपका, यहाँ से आपका सिस्टम ऑन ही रहेगा।
अच्छा सिस्टम ऑन रहेगा, ठीक है।
हाँ जी सर, आप कनेक्ट करो। नो नो सर, डिसकनेक्ट करने की नीड नहीं है, आप कनेक्ट ही रहिए, 2 बजे हम स्टार्ट कर देंगे यहीं से।
अच्छा ठीक है,
ठीक है।
राजीव सर आपने जो काम किया है उसमें से दो तीन पेपर निकल सकते होंगे। हाँ अलग अलग उसको अलग वे में होते तो है राजीव सर से पूछ लेना राजीव सर सर है ना मुझे नहीं फिर हम लोग इसको पब्लिश करें
Hello. Hello.
Hello. Hello.
Yes, sir. You can continue your session.
Camera ठीक है.
Sir, वो screen share ही करेंगे जी ना. Screen share ही करेंगे sir. Sir का camera नहीं.
हाँ.
करना नहीं. So you can open your presentation now. Yes, sir.
Is it okay?
Yes, sir. Hello. सर आपकी आवाज क्लियर नहीं आ रही है मे बी इंटरनेट इश्यू है टिप साइड हेलो सर आपकी आवाज नहीं क्लियर आ रही है इंटरनेट इश्यू है आपके वहां हेलो सर अगर आप मुझे सुन पा रहे हैं तो राइट हेलो हां जी सर
हेलो आ रही है आवाज आप
हाँ जी सर आ रही है
ब्लूटूथ कनेक्टेड है तब एक्चुअली ओके
सर हमारे सारे पार्टिसिपेंट आ गए हैं व्हेन यू आर रेडी वी कैन स्टार्ट द प्रोग्राम
You can see my presentation.
Yes, we were able.
Sir,
to
no, see sir. आप right click करके एक बार reload करिए पहले. आपके internet issue है. Sir, आप अपनी screen पे right click करके reload कर लीजिए. Yes, sir. YouTube. Sir, hello. आप ना राइट क्लिक करके रीलोड कर लीजिए, जो आपकी स्क्रीन है ना उस पर राइट क्लिक करके रीलोड कर लीजिए, फिर दोबारा स्क्रीन शेयर करिए, इंटरनेट में इश्यू आ रहा है. सर राइट क्लिक एंड रीलोड. सर गूगल हैंगआउट की विंडो पे करना है रीलोड, आप पहले हैंगआउट की स्क्रीन पे जाइए. सर आपका वही ना इंटरनेट स्लो है इसलिए आपकी आवाज भी कट रही है ना, आपकी बैंडविड्थ में प्रॉब्लम आई है अभी. मॉर्निंग में बिल्कुल ठीक थी सर,
अभी भी ठीक हो.
सो लेट्स सी, आप एक बार कर दीजिए रीलोड करके स्क्रीन शेयर कर दीजिए फिर से. ठीक है सर, वो दिन में ना थोड़ा बैंडविड्थ फ्लक्चुएट करती है ना तो कम हो जाती है. सो अदरवाइज मैं आपको फिर से रिक्वेस्ट ही सेंड करती हूँ, आप कॉल ही ज्वाइन कर लीजिए जीमेल पे. हेलो हेलो सर, इतना टाइम यूजुअली लगता नहीं है, आपका इंटरनेट इश्यू है वो बाद में भी तंग करेगा ही, आपकी आवाज नहीं आएगी. आप बैंडविड्थ चेक कर सकते हैं, ऊकला से स्पीड टेस्ट हो जाएगा ऑनलाइन इंटरनेट का. यस सर, आपके ना वो आपको सिस्टम से मेरी आवाज आ रही है? मैं बोल रही हूँ कुछ, हेलो 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 हेलो, वही तो सर, ये कॉल आपकी ज्वाइन हुई ना हुई एक ही बराबर है, क्योंकि आपका नेट नहीं चल रहा।
अब आ गए, ठीक है ठीक।
अब आप कोई
स्क्रीन शेयर कर दीजिए। यस सर, सर फुल स्क्रीन पे करके स्टार्ट कर दीजिए लेक्चर। यस सर कंटिन्यू, यू कैन कंटिन्यू नाउ।
चल ठीक है, लेट अस स्टार्ट है। ओके, सो गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन। सो नाउ वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट विद द take up some case study in the course outcome. So in the morning session, you know, I told you that starting from the hierarchy of vision, mission and PEOs and PO, the last one at the very important one is course outcome. Course outcome means for every subject that you are teaching, each subject, each course must have some course outcomes that are known as expected outcomes of the course. That is what the students are expected to know and be able to do at the end of the course. So for this, I have a case study with me on the subject of total quality management. See, this is a structure which is conventional. You know, you have some number of credits, LTP, sessional theory, and all those things. And then you have a syllabus, course contents. So these course contents are normally written in unit-wise, you know, or maybe section-wise. So this is the syllabus. Now, based on this syllabus, I have to write down in 4 to 6 lines what is expected when a student has completed this course. So, say for example, these are the course outcomes of the course on total quality management. At the end of the course, a student would be able to, number one, illustrate the dimensions of quality and origin of TQM. Similarly, classify and correlate various factors of TQM, analyze the role of soft options in TQM, reduce students use TQM, describe various, and the sixth one is analyze the impact of TQM. The important point is in each of these lines, the outcome of what is there. And each of the course outcome has got a verb of Bloom taxonomy. Illustrate, classify, correlate, analyze, deduce, describe, and analyze again. So course outcomes which are 4 to 6 in number, so for example these are 6 in number, they describe that at the end of the course what a student will be able to do. So very importantly, a check is that whenever you write those outcomes, please ensure that can be related to these course outcomes. That is, the whole syllabus has been taking the course out. And depending on the type of subject, you will see that there are different levels of learning as per the Bloom's taxonomy. What we are expecting that a student will learn. Say for example, classify can be at a lower level and analyze can be at a higher level. So it is not necessary that all the 6 levels of Bloom's taxonomy are to be covered in a single course outcome. Sorry, in a single course. It might be possible that there is a subject which is only basic in nature. Say, for example, basic electronics, basic principles of management, or there can be a course which is quite advanced one. Say, for example, design of jigs and fixtures. So depending on the type of course, you will see that the course outcomes will contain various levels of the Bloom's taxonomy. Now, each of these course outcomes has to be mapped with the program outcome also, which is known as COPO mapping. Say, for example, there are 12 program outcomes, PO 1 to PO 12, that you see at the top. And in the first column, I have written course outcomes, which are 1 to 6 in number. Each has a mapping, has a relationship with a PO, which can be one or more than one. Say, for example, 705.1 has a mapping with PO1 and PO12 only. Now, if this mapping is there, then we are again saying that this mapping is on a scale of 1, 2, and 3. 3 means the mapping is very strong or the high, 2 means medium, and 1 means low. And it is possible that a particular course outcome, say 705.1 or 2 or so on, may not lead to a particular program outcome. Say, for example, there is no mapping between 705.3, that is a third outcome, with the PO2, PO3, PO4. You see dash in that. So that means there is no mapping, whereas others there are mapping 2, 1, 2, 3, whatever it is. Now, this has to be justified by a teacher or a group of experts that what is the level of this mapping and whether it is there or not. And that you have to finally justified that how you have written number of 1, 2, 3 based on the interaction or based on the how this course outcome is leading to the mapping in the program outcome. Now, based on these numbers, you know, at the end I have written an average also, which say that whatever is the total, you know, I have divided by the number of the course outcomes. Say, for example, in the second column in PO, you see 2 + 1 = 3 divided by the 6, that is 0.5. This whole matrix is giving me a mapping which is by the name, known as by the name of COPO mapping. And based on this mapping, for a single subject, like that one I did was for the 705. Now, similarly, for each subject, you have to draw a matrix like this for each subject, find out the average in each case, and transfer that average into the main matrix, that is the mapping, where mapping of all the subjects there. Say, for example, in this, you see last row is 2.33, 0.5, 0.16 and so on. So this I have copied here in the row of 705. So likewise, all the subjects will have this COPO mapping. Is that clear? So once that mapping has been done, then I would be able to find out the average. The average figure will show that how these course outcomes are finally leading into the program outcomes through the curriculum. Now, this is another example. This is another example, a course on electromagnetic engineering. So here again, there are 5 course outcomes. Now, very important part is the first line written is at the end of the course, a student would be able to. That means I am talking in future tense. At the end of the course, I expect that this would be done. Calculate, apply, relate, select. You see, in each of these cases, again, there is a verb which has been taken from the Bloom's taxonomy, and that defines that what is the level of learning in each of these cases. Another example. Now, in when students, they go for a plant training or a training, there again, there are certain course outcomes. That why, when a student goes to course outcomes, what is expected out of him or her when they complete the training? So, at the end of the training or at the end, a student would be able to get familiarized with the various technological trends, approaches and applications, demonstrate understanding of relevant application-oriented subjects in a better perspective. Describe the scope, functions, and job responsibilities in various departments of an organization. Get awareness and exposure to industrial work environment. And finally, work upon industrial project and team. So it is expected that when a student's complete industry training, this is what is expected. So likewise, I have shown you two or three examples. So likewise, you will have to write down the course outcomes for each of the courses, all the subjects that you are teaching in the diploma. And based on that, then you will have to do the COP. At the end of an extra one. Okay. Now, just to write down all these course outcomes, very important part is assessment and attainment of COs. That means when I write the course outcomes, then you prepare a COP matrix, and then in our system, state board system, or in a university system, you know, there is a breakup of marks. That say, for example, university exam or the end term exam 70%, sessional test 20%, continuous assessment 10%. So this makes 100. So all this has to be taken care in terms of the direct assessment. When I talk about overall assessment, as I told you earlier also, there are two types of assessment, direct assessment and indirect assessment. Now, as per the recommendations of the document, we are giving 80% credit to the direct assessment and 20% credit to the indirect assessment. In direct assessment, we include all those marks that we are giving, maybe in examination, final exam, or the session test, or maybe in the continuous assessment. Whereas indirect assessment is primarily through indirect means through survey, which is also known as a course survey or the course exit survey. So when this all has been, you know, these lines have been drawn based on the system, which can be different in different institutions. We have set some lines. It can be three, you know, levels, which can be one, two, or three. So I say that if 60% of students secure more than 60% marks, then attainment level is the lowest one, that is the one. If 70% students score more than 60% marks, then the attainment level is 2. And finally, attainment level is 3 when 80% of the students secure more than 60% marks. Now, these figures are only recommended figures. You can always have, you know, higher target or this target depending on the time. Similarly, for example, if the target is 60%, in all the three attainment levels, the target is 60%. So this 60% target can be 65% also, 70 also, you know, or it can relate to certain class average also, or say board average also. And here the markers are 60, 70, and 80. So attainment level one is that it's been 60% students secure marks. Attainment level two is been 70% students secure marks, and attainment level three is 80% students secure marks and 60%. Now the 60, 70, 80 can also be increased as a benchmark each year. Say for example, in first year you say 60 or 60, 65, 70. Next time you can say the target level is higher, 65, 70, 75 or so. So what I mean to say is that these are markers, these are the levels which we have set. And you can always, you know, have a discussion that what should be the level set in a particular institution, which can be different from different for different institutions. Similarly, you can have same or you can have different markers, attainment levels for midterm exam and the end term exam. Here I have shown you differently, they can be same also. So normally students are able to secure in, you know, midterm exam, so the level they are kept is 60%, but here the target level set is little less, that is 50%. So attainment level one is achieved when 60% students secure more than 50% marks. Similarly, for level two, 70% securing more than 50% marks, and for attainment level three, 80% students securing more than 50% marks. So you see, all these levels are just set so that now we can find out that what is the attainment level of my class or attainment level of my students. So similarly, this is for the indirect method, that is a course and survey. Here again, attainment levels are set up. So for example, attainment level is 1 when average score of 60 plus students is more than 3 on a scale of 5. And similarly, level 2, when 70% student average is more than 3, and attainment level 3, when 80% students is more than 3. So this also will take up. Now let's see the first one with the help of an example. Now say for example, this is a class of 10 students. I am trying to show you that how you are CO assessment and attainment is being done. You have written course outcomes. Now you have to assess, you have to check up whether they have been actually achieved, actually attained or not. So as a example, I am taking a class which is only of 10 students, and there are two class tests, and based on which students have secured marks, and the class average comes out to be out of 27. So I go to the reference value for the class. If I had set this, if 6% that in this class, students are securing marks more. So in the last row, students secured more than 60% marks. So in the last row, the level written is 2 over there. Where this 2 has come? These 2 has come from this one. Second bullet. Attended is 2, then 70% students, they secure more than 60% marks out of the relevant maximum marks. So this level is 2. Similarly, when I talk about assignment, there I see that students have marks like 9, 8, 7, and so on. There I 90% students are securing marks as per the rule. Similarly, for the another examination, I know that marks coming out to be. Now, based on these attainment levels, I find that since the university has got a credit of 70%. 7% of from this does all 20% of continuous assessment, 10% credit, percent of 3. I want that the attainment subject that is the two. That 80% I am here to the indirect assessment is 20%. So now I go for the indirect assessment and I did a course and survey. Course and survey is nothing but a survey or a survey format wherein I try to find out through the survey by the questions that whether course outcome have been attained. Why this is in some cases students are unable to secure due to some reason or other. Number one, is their own understanding that they have So based on this, based on the survey form, the course and survey average for form number one was 3.5 on a scale of 5. That is, lot many questions were asked to them and average was coming out to be 3.5. For form number 2 it was 3.4 and so on. And finally I found that the average score of 90% of the students is greater than 3, greater than 60%. So which says that the attainment level is 3 in this case. Now you will see that I have written form number instead of roll number, which means that I am not asking the identity of the students. I'm not asking the identity of the students. I'm just giving them form and they are filling up, and then I am calculating the score. So I do not want them to write their name also or roll number also, so that you are unable to identify them directly. So based on this, the attainment level in the course and survey is coming out to be 3. And you remember that 20% of the credit is given to the indirect assessment. So based on this, I found that attainment of course outcome for this subject by indirect means is 3, and 20% of 3 is 0.6. So if I add this up, then I get that by direct assessment, 80% credit I am getting 2.1. By indirect assessment, 20% credit I am getting 3. So 80% of 2.1, because 80% credit is to be given to direct assessment, 20% of 3, because 20% of credit is given to the indirect assessment. So the overall attainment of this course comes out to be 1.68 plus 0.6, that is 2.28 on a scale of 3. So this is how you calculate the attainment level of a course. So like this, you will have to calculate the, you have to first write down the COs for all the courses, and finally you have to calculate the attainment of all the courses that you have. Now this is only for the COs, that is a course outcome, but our final target is the program outcome. So many courses, when they combine like this, program outcome. So this is the initial matrix, the repeat matrix of COP mapping, and this is the matrix for the compliance of curriculum for any viewer. That is, I'm saying the average I was writing down in the row base. Now this is not attainment, this is just mapping. Now based on what has been attained in CO, accordingly I will be able to calculate the what is the attainment of the particular CO. So first I add another second column by the name of CO attainment. So you find the CO attainment for MC 2.28 has come from this slide. Then I calculate 2.28. So likewise, I will be having the CO attainment for all the. Then when I want to find the CO attainment, so if you refer to the column under PO, I have written within brackets 2.28 into 2.33 divided by 3, which is equal to 1.7. What is this? 2.28 is the CO attainment. 2.3 is the. Because it is on a scale. So that means if the mapping is strong, then only I will be able to get a PO attainment in that case. If the mapping is not strong, say for example, if in the second column of PO2 you find it is only 0.5. So 0.5 means 2.28 into 0.5 divided by 3. So in that case, the PO attainment is coming 0.38. So likewise, I am just showing you for PO1 and for PO8 that how this calculation is being done. And then I am able to find out PO attainment in each of the cases. So this matrix whole will then be filled up for all the courses. Once I find out the CO attainment, I will be able to find out the PO attainment by this method. So this can be easily done in an Excel sheet when you have got already, you know, formulas with you. And in this way, you will be able to find out the direct attainment for each of the POs. So once you find out the direct attainment, then your job will be to find out the indirect attainment. Like I told you, 80% of credit in CO attainment and PO attainment both is for the direct assessment, and 20% is for the indirect assessment. So when you do a survey from industry, survey from the employer, then you are able to find out that what is the survey score, and accordingly indirect assessment you will be able to find out. So total will be indirect assessment, PO attainment W will be 80% of direct assessment and 20% of the indirect assessment. This is how we will be able to find out the PO at any level. This is a calculation part, actually looks little tedious, but it is very simple. Once you understand this, and once you have done, you know, some work in Excel, and then directly you will be able to transfer this and you will be able to get this. Now, this is, are there any questions? Because this whole methodology is complete now. How do you find out all these things?
Sir, no question. They are saying no question.
Hello, okay. So now this is the method when you are finding out on the basis of the average of the class. You know, one of the very important things in this case is, say for example, we talk about this rule. Now this rule talks about the whole class. So 60% of students scoring more than 60% marks. Now what happens is, in certain cases, you know, in this, you are not able to get accurate results when you are averaging the things. So another method of doing this is, when you are able to find out for individual students that what all attainment has been done by them. So I think that methodology is applicable, you know, primarily not for the directly for the polytechnics, but for autonomous colleges or for the universities. So I think I could have shown you just for your interest, but otherwise you will be only referring to, you know, those cases. Yeah, say for example, are you able to see this Excel sheet?
Yes, sir.
Okay, now this, I am not trying to, you know, make you, that you learn this methodology right now, but just see that how it is different from the other one. Now this is the same thing, you know, the same case study, CO2 mapping done, you know. Now this is CO test mapping. Now what does the CO test mapping says is that, in each case you find out that in, say, class test number one, so the ideal method is that in each class test, in front of question write down it is mapping with which CO. So say for example, in class test one and class test two, the three questions 1, 2, 3 are mapping with CO1, CO2 and CO3, and in class test two they are mapping with CO4, CO5. Similarly, in the final examination also you see that there is a mapping in terms that question number one, are you able to see the cursor? Yeah, question number one has these parts. Now each of these parts, which is of 2 marks, is mapped with some of the COs, CO1, CO1, CO2, CO3, CO5. And similarly, other question 10 marks each, they are also mapping with some COs, CO1, CO2, 3, 4, and 6, and so on. So finally, seeing this question paper and their mapping with the COs, I am able to find out this metric that how many marks are allotted for each CO out of this quarter of marks. System to that what is the percentage of covered. You see that the whole of this, the 15 to 20% is the average range where all COs are covered in the question paper. So this means that at average, the whole is equally distributed. Similarly, now based on this, if I go to, I will only show you this one only. So if you see in this case once again, now this has been done for a particular CO. Say for example, this is for CO1. So I will have to find out that each student has secured how many marks while he or she was attempting a question relating to CO1. So for that, I have to first find out that where all CO1 was covered. CO1 was covered in test 1 in question number 1. In test 2, there was no CO. Whereas in end-time examination, CO1, 1B, 1A, 1B, 1H, 2A and 2B. So that was the, now based on this, how much a student has secured in each question will help me to find out that how much he has attained that particular CO. So this is the marks that the student has secured. I'm not going to explain to you in detail because you are more concerned with the previous methodology. But just to give you a feel, likewise, you develop for each CO, you develop a matrix like this, Excel sheet like this. Okay. Similarly, this is for CO3 now. And finally, the result will be similar only. So here again, I am able to find out the COPU matrix. In this COPU matrix and the attainment of COs, I am able to find out that the similar results will come, but here the results will be more accurate. Why? Because I have taken the individual score of attainment of each student instead of the average score that we have done in the previous one. Okay, so I again come to my this presentation. So this is how, you know, you have to write down the course outcomes, how you have to map the COPO, and then how you have to check that how much is the assessment and the attainment of each of the COs. So this is it about, you know, the concept of COPO, attainment assessment. So if there are any questions, otherwise we can wrap up.
No questions. No questions, sir.
Okay, if there are no questions, then please wrap up the session.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, sir. Any question? कोई question नहीं है.
No, ma'am.
So, sir, thank you. If there are
okay, thank you. If there are no questions, yeah.
You can disconnect the call.
Okay, thank you.